Dodds Furniture's The Show is brought to you by Dodds Furniture and Mattress. Now open in Nanaimo.
Lawn Social. They're our musical guests today. Hi there and welcome to the show. Matt Carter is off tonight. I'm Kait Burgan. It looks like we're in for a great and varied 60 minutes. The sound check with these guys sounded fantastic. We're looking forward to hearing more over the course of the next hour. Also in the lineup, Floral Art. The Oceanside Rotary's James Bond Gala is just around the corner and we'll have more details on that. We're talking to local author Gail Boulanger about her book Adventures Over 60, and there's a Toastmasters conference coming up as well. We're going to look into techniques for dealing with depression also in the course of the next 60 minutes. And what is photo encaustic? I don't know, but if we stick around, you'll know by the end of this show. Let's get things started.
My name is Lorraine Jensen, and my guest this afternoon is Helen Musio. And Helen is from the Mid-Island Floral Art Club. Welcome, Helen.
Thank you, Lorraine.
Thanks for being here. Now, Helen is going to make us today. What are you going to make us, Helen?
Well, we're going to do a spring flower arrangement today because it's the first day of spring.
It is.
Good planning. So we'll just start right away. First of all, we want to use a basic container, so we're going to make our own. And then I'll be using product that I've gathered from nature, plus some flowers from the garden and some that I purchased at the local flower shop. So I'll just get you to move a bit. And I've cut a piece of planking just to the size to fit my container. Now this is a 4-inch dish, a 10-inch dish, I should say, costs $4. We wished it was the other way around. Maybe not. So next I'm going to cut my dry foam to fit the size of the dish.
Okay.
So I've used one full block and I slice it in half.
Okay.
And then I take the middle section and shape it to fit the container.
Okay.
Then the two side pieces you also shape and just so they're all set to go.
Good idea.
So once I've done that, these need to soak, and they must just soak slowly in fresh water with flower food. Very important. So I just
I don't feed my kids, let alone my flowers.
Pot of water and let it slowly sink. While that is soaking, then we prepare our anchor pins. And to do this, you use a little bit of stickum on the bottom.
You got these from a pizza.
No, I didn't. Pizza got the idea from us.
Oh, okay.
We were first. So they're cheating. Anyhow, we just secure these on, fit these, that's right.
I might take this up yet.
Well, you could enjoy it.
Oh,
it's lots of fun. You make lots of friends and you learn a new art form. And we're really trying to promote floral designing as a proper art form.
Okay.
So now we have those in there. Then we're going to bring our soaked foam over and put the middle one in first and just secure it on the pins right in the middle, and then our other pieces.
Where do you buy this stuff?
At the flower shop, or I think Michael's carries some of it. But the flower shop is a good place to start because they use lots of them.
I'm sure they do.
So just press it down in. Now, I like to have added security so my design won't fall over. The physical stability is very important, so we use what is called green floral tape. How original is that? So then I just secure it around each end of the dish.
Okay.
You don't want your tape in the middle because that's where your flowers are going to go.
Okay.
So.
And what are those twigs for?
Well, we're going to find that out. Don't get ahead of me.
Okay, I got it, because we've got to wrap up in a second or two.
Oh, well, they would give me more time, wouldn't they?
Oh!
Because they're so nice. So, we're going to start making our container with these branches that I have gathered from the bush, and they have wonderful lichen on them. Okay. Now, I like to glue them on.
Okay, so you know what? We're going to glue them on together. Okay. While the next set is on. And right now, we are going to move over to Fenty, Bob Fenty, who is here talking with Trina Brubaker and Garth Bush about the James Bond night that's coming up. So over to you.
Thanks, Lorraine. And as she mentioned, tonight we do have 007 is with us this evening, or this afternoon, I should say. The Oceanside Rotarians, Garth Bush and Trina Brubaker are here to talk about the 15th annual James Bond night, going to be held very, very soon. Welcome, Trina and Garth. Glad to have you on the show. And Garth, there's some legacy going on here. This is your 15th, and there's some other significance there as well, too, isn't there?
It certainly is. This is our 15th year of this James Bond event, and it's 50 years of James Bond films. So we're celebrating two anniversaries. Take 50 years.
And those two numbers are kind of neat, aren't they? If you multiply them, we get
15 times 50 is $750,000, which is the amount
of
money.
That's what this Rotary Club has raised, $750,000. Wow.
That's right. We're very proud of that.
Trina, the theme this year is the man with the golden gun.
It is.
I've got a poster we can show while you're talking about that.
We feature a different James Bond film every year, and it's a really fun way to set the theme for the evening and to encourage people to dress up and get into character and come out for a fabulous evening. And it brings the community together. It's an evening about getting together, having fun, interacting with other community members, and giving back to your community while doing this.
Wonderful, yeah. So, as we mentioned, your club, Garth, has raised a considerable sum of money. How does that get distributed around the community?
We have various things that we support. A good portion of what we do with the James Bond event is to the Nanaimo Ladysmith School Division breakfast program. We've raised a significant amount for that. We also have the field house on 3rd Avenue that our club was involved in the construction of. Various other community events, including Big Brothers, Big Sisters, our support, and a large number of other ones.
Thank you. That's great. Yeah, amazing. And now, this evening, Trina, that we're planning is on the 13th. We'll talk about that in a minute. But April the 13th coming up, there's some entertainment going to be taking place. Tell us about that, will you?
Well, aside from socializing with Garth and myself, we have a silent auction, and we have a live auction with a professional auctioneer. We're featuring a floor show by Flying Dreams Aerial Arts Productions, a company based out of Salt Spring. That's going to be absolutely fantastic. The Great Canadian Casino has kindly donated tables and dealers for our casino portion of the evening, and we'll be featuring dancing and music with Electric Kool-Aid, Nanaimo's premier classic rock band.
And you mentioned earlier about floor show.
The floor show, that's Flying Dreams Aerial Arts Production, and that's going to be a very Cirque du Soleil Vegas-ish. It's going to be amazing. You'll have to see it to really appreciate what they have to offer.
Sounds really great. So, and Garth, now sponsorship for this event it's important. Tell us how some people can get involved in sponsoring.
Sure. So the presenting sponsor for this year is Canadian Tire, and we have a number of other sponsorship opportunities, and we have lined up some sponsors. The levels of sponsorship opportunities, and I'll take the opportunity to read this so I don't get it wrong. We have an associate producer level sponsorship, which creates a number of things for the business, but specifically you get a free room to entertain your clients, plus a number of other opportunities. Then we have the director sponsorship, which is a sponsorship that allows you to have a table at the event, plus your corporate logo on some special event, such as the coat check or some such other thing. We have certain media sponsors that have become involved. We have the actors, which we call, and that's the auction prize donors, and we're always looking for people who want to contribute things for our silent auction or for our live auction. And finally, there's the audience. And the audience is what we would really like to fill up. We think it'll be a great time and a great opportunity to raise funds for the community. You can buy a corporate table of 10 for $1,250, individual tickets at $150 each, and it will be a great event.
Busy, busy, busy night. It sounds like fabulous. Now, there's going to be some dancing too, Trina, is there?
There will be. Electric Kool-Aid will be playing this year. They feature classic rock. They're a wonderful band, and it will be an entertaining evening.
So we can dance the night away.
We can dance the night away.
Well, there you have it, folks. Shaken, not stirred, at James Bond Night down at the Convention Center on April the 13th. If you want more information, contact any member of the Nanaimo Rotary Oceanside Club, or give Garth or Trina a call. Their number should be appearing on your screen. And we look forward to having a great, great success this year. So now let's go back over to Lorraine, who's doing something with roses and daisies and having fun. There you go. Back to you, Lorraine.
Thanks, Bob. Thank you. Well, that event sounds like an awful lot of fun. And in the 4 minutes that you've spent talking to our guests about James Bond, look what Helen and I together have created. Welcome back, Helen.
A lot.
I have learned a lot to stay out of the way.
No.
So show us what you've done here, Helen.
Well, we built up the container with the branches and lichen, simulating a forest floor or whatever, and then put the spring flowers in, pussy willows, and I've done it in a blocking color style. But I've also added these interesting pieces.
Yeah, because you know what? I got 5 acres, but I don't have any of these. So what is that?
That's magic.
It is.
It's hyacinths. And you just put a bead on a fairly heavy gauge wire. If you're familiar with your wires, it's a number 18. And thread the hyacinths after you've cut the little flowerets off.
So this is a real flower.
It's a real flower right off the hyacinth. And so then you make a nice garland, used quite often in wedding work, or just adding a nice rhythm to the whole arrangement.
That is beautiful. I you know what? I couldn't have come up with that by myself.
Sure you could.
No. No, really. So tell me, why do you do this?
Because I love flowers. It's a passion. I'm passionate about flowers. I love designing with them. I love art. And I love to teach. I love doing demonstrations. And all of our art club are very involved in some of the community activities at Milner Garden and at the old schoolhouse at our art gallery. And we just like to have fun and play around and to teach.
This isn't playing around. I mean, this really is art. And you said to me on the phone when we talked that, you know, you really wanted people to know that this is an art.
It is an art form. We think of, you know, the visual arts, watercolor, oil paintings, acrylic, and then, you know, the performance arts. But people never really perceive flower designing as an art. And yet we follow all the basic principles and elements of art.
Well, that's absolutely fantastic. So how did you get these, you know, like I trip across this in my yard. How do you get that attached to this $4 plate?
I use a hot glue pan as opposed to a glue gun. It's easier, and you just dip it in the glue and stick it on and build it up. So what
you
helped.
My hands.
We used, we built it up, then we put the flowers in, and then we just put in a few dried leaves from the last winter, because you'll see those as things grow in the garden, and a few feathers from birds that have lost their feathers in the spring. So it just gives it that natural appearance with spring coming up out of the garden.
So I just want to make a plug. If anybody needs any of these leaves, I still have lots of them in my yard.
She'll rake them up for you.
No, I didn't say that first.
But the Mid-Island Floral Art Club, we are in Qualicum. And if anyone is interested in becoming a member or just coming as a guest, our website is www.mifac.org.
So www.mifac.org.
Yes, the letters are the first letters in the word Mid-Island Floral Art Club.
Thank you. Helen, it has been an absolute pleasure to spend this time with you this afternoon. I've really appreciated it. This is absolutely beautiful and absolutely an art. So thank you again.
I've totally enjoyed it.
Well, thank you. So I'm going to throw things back now over to Joan. And my mother's here this evening, and she's here, and maybe she can listen to some tips about the book that Joan's talking about, which is Adventures of Over 60. Over to you, Joan.
And I am here with Gail Boulanger, and she has written two books, and we're going to be talking about them both because they're similar in nature, and they have to do with loss and grief, and also reclaiming your life after 60. Is that a good way to describe it?
Reclaiming your life, I think, and also vibrant living.
Right.
And I guess the books are very good companions for each other, because one of the things that I found in my work is that people who learn to grieve well learn to live well and vibrantly.
Right. So then you actually wrote the first book, The Life After 60? Oh, sorry, Adventures Over 60. This first book that I have here, you wrote that in 2002 and then you redistributed it or republished it.
No, Adventures Over 60 came out in 2012, just last September.
Okay,
it's my second book.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
And so both of them deal with basically the same kind of issues. And you are a counselor and you are a psychotherapist, mm-hmm. and you still practice that one-on-one kind of therapy with people as well. So tell me about your writing career though.
My writing career really grew out of my practice with clients, because with Life Goes On was my first book, and I really wanted to give my clients more information about grief and loss so they would have things to refer to in between sessions.
Right.
I always gave handouts and that wasn't ever quite enough.
Oh, that's interesting.
So that's what Life Goes On was really written for my clients.
Right. And so you describe yourself as an islander. You were transplanted from the
yes.
prairies. And you're living in the news, and so that's where your practice is right now. So tell me, you've been in practice for 30 years now.
I've been in practice now for over 30 years, mm-hmm. And I've worked in hospitals and hospices and schools, and I've had my private practice for a very, very long time, which is what I prefer, having clients in my office. Adventures Over 60 really began as I was approaching closing my practice, which I did for a while, and
right.
I really wanted to explore what life over 60 looked like. And so I wrote about it, and I interviewed a lot of people, and I talked to a lot of people, and I read all kinds of books on healthy aging.
Right. And you, it starts with you turning 60, you're at 59,
right.
and contemplating turning 60.
That's right.
And
yeah.
so it really is a personal story as well. It's it's your story, and
it
it's
is.
Also your clients, I would imagine, as well.
Not with Adventures Over 60. Adventures Over 60 is all true stories,
mm-hmm.
and they're true stories that rely on family, friends, neighbors, community members. I was living the experiences as I wrote about them,
right.
and as I observed in my community, there's a wonderful story in Adventures Over 60 about Nanu's post office, and other people who were particularly kind to me during those years, and then I got permission from them to tell certain stories.
Okay.
Adventures Over 60 really also emphasizes the need for creative expression, like floral art, or really getting lots of really good exercise and taking care of ourselves. It also shines the light on the need for the inner resources, like
right.
meditation.
You say that we need to trust the answers that bubble up from inside ourselves.
Yes.
And I love the way that you put that.
Thank you.
That's a great yeah. way of putting it. So we're really learning to trust ourselves and our own instincts.
Yes. And it really is about understanding that our intuition needs to be respected, because our intuition is based on our life experience.
Right.
And over time, the more we trust our intuition and also run it through a good evaluation and judgment process, but we can learn to really trust ourselves. And I think that's the emphasis on both, in both Life Goes On and Adventures Over 60.
Well, that's great. And people can go to your website, which is at the bottom of the screen, and they can find out more about both of the books, each of the books. And they're just great books. I was really enjoying them. I'm not quite there yet myself.
Thank you.
But good preparation. And I think for anybody that's dealing with loss and grief, it's a great resource.
Good.
And so now we're going to go to Lawn Social, and we're going to have something completely different, which is the drinking song. And I guess that's all part of the whole process, too. Over to Lawn Social.
Good night to start drinking. Have I made a big mistake? Well, does she know my name? Will I be home this spring? 'Cause I'm skipping stores. I can feel you drifting as I try to carry your tune. My mind wanders and you get me wishing that you had it left so soon. Well, does she know my name? Will I be home this spring? 'Cause I'm a sinking storm. 'Cause I'm too late. I guess I'm too
Well, there you have it. That was Lawn Social, an excellent local band performing for us. Next, we're going to talk about, about talking. My guest is Lee Mason. She's with Toastmasters, and they have a convention coming up here in Nanaimo in May, I think it is. Tell us about it.
Right. It's actually May the 3rd through the 5th, and it's going to be hosted by the Coast Bastion Inn, and it's an opportunity for Toastmasters from all over the province to gather in Nanaimo and further their education around communicating.
How many are there organizations? Like, it seems almost every community has a Toastmasters club.
At least one. There are 116 countries that have Toastmasters clubs, and we've got about 8 different clubs in and around the Nanaimo area. They meet at different times, different places, and they have a different demographic, but they can be anybody, your co-workers, your neighbors, your friends, your family. Toastmasters come from everywhere.
And with the conference coming up here in Nanaimo, about how many people do you expect that might be coming to town for that?
It varies. Anywhere from 200 to 300 people will come from all over the province.
Well, that's excellent. Tell us a little about what is Toastmasters, what do they do? It's not a service club.
Right, and we know nothing about making toast. That's a little in-joke, everybody thinks that that's what it's about. It's about learning how to communicate, learning how to think on your feet. It's about learning how to provide feedback in a way that's supportive and energizing. And it's a self-help group. You learn by doing. And what we've learned is that you learn more by making mistakes in a safe environment than you do by reading a book. So Toastmasters is a club. Members get together regularly and they practice different skills. Listening is an important skill.
I've noticed too that a lot of people are totally frightened out of their wits if they ever have to do any
Yes.
public speaking. And Toastmasters is designed to help people get over, well, I guess you'd call it stage fright.
Exactly, and the neatest thing about that is that it often takes a motivating factor to get someone to join Toastmasters. So usually April to May, when people are getting ready for weddings, you'd be surprised how many men join the Toastmasters organizations in their community because they're the best man, and they need to give the toast to the bride. It's that, hilarious.
Yeah, that can be challenging, but it can also be fun. Talking again about the conference, I noticed the notes here talk about using technology to make an impact with your audience.
Absolutely, because technology, if used well, is a wonderful enhancement. If it's not used well and not done right, it can totally destroy your message.
And as well as talking, listening is also an effective skill.
Absolutely. And it's one of the skills that we practice on a regular basis because we have to provide feedback to all of the speakers. So in order to do that, you have to really listen. You have to listen to the entire message, not only the spoken word, but the kinesthetic message as well.
But I noticed there's a lot of networking skills involved in talking to other people, having other people talking at the same time, so you understand what they go through and they see what you go through.
Absolutely. One of the skills that you learn as a Toastmaster is the ability to interact in a group, to give that 30-second elevator speech, some people call it. Well, what do you do for a living? Oh, really? Yeah. What does that mean and how does that relate? How long have you been doing that? Wonderful questions that you can exchange dialogue with other people.
And with that, I see Kait is standing by. She's practicing her Toastmaster skills. Kait?
Thank you very much, Merv. I have considered joining Toastmasters in the past. I've never actually had the opportunity to. And speaking to a camera like I am right now, and my hand is shaking a little bit because there's also a live studio audience. And it is always a little bit more challenging to speak to real people who aren't sort of smirking or not paying attention or too much attention. And there really is a live feel to this show. We do record this show live to tape, which means we don't stop and then restart or do any editing. What happens is what you see. I haven't been in front of this camera in this studio for about a year now. And we started the show about a year before that as a way to engage volunteers in television production. So I don't know how many people are here in the studio right now. If I was to guess, I'd say, about 10 to 15 crew. There's a lot of guests and their support people here, their friends and their family. And out of all of those people, there are 4 staff people here. The rest is done entirely by volunteers. And there's lots of opportunities for you to engage with your local television station. You can do that by emailing melissa.hall@sjrb.ca. If you would like to be a guest on the show, most of the interviews that you see here have been requested to us through various members in the community. A final little plug, I'm getting the signal that they're ready to go over on the main set again, but we do have a Facebook page. It's Shaw TV, Central Vancouver Island. You can also follow us on Twitter. Our handle is @ShawTV_CVI. And I'm not done quite yet. I'm back and I'm known for going over, which is exactly what I'm going to do right now. Todd in the control room is going, really? This is what she does? Because I want to tell you about an upcoming event. It's from Theatre One. They are presenting Ride the Cyclone at the Vancouver Island University Theater, April 25th to 29th. Now, it's a very short run, so you're not going to have a lot of chance to hear word of mouth locally about the show, but I can tell you what the Globe and Mail is saying. The Globe and Mail says that this is Glee meets Survivor. The province says one of the strangest, most stylish and entertaining musicals of recent years. So yes, Theater One is bringing a musical theater production to Vancouver Island University April 25th to 29th. And now they're groaning in the studio because I'm going to throw things over to Lorraine Jensen. She's going to talk about how you can deal with depression.
Hi. Thanks, Kait. I love Kait. She's just so great. My next guest this afternoon is Maria Yerema, and Maria has written a book. Welcome, Maria.
Thank you, Lorraine.
So, Maria, your book is called No Longer Alone, 365 Loving Suggestions on How to Recover from Depression.
Yes, it's a tip per day, and it offers practical information and suggestions on things you can actually do in order to feel better. When I was first diagnosed, you know, there's sort of a three-prong approach, drugs, counseling, and lifestyle changes. And he said, we need to make lifestyle changes. And I said, I can barely get out of bed. What does that mean? You're not at your most creative. So there's lots of ideas of things to try and ways to remember things that you used to love to do. one of the symptoms of depression is you don't do the things that you love to do. So I was asked to make a list, and I couldn't think of a single thing that I enjoyed. It was a very sad moment for me. So this is just to stimulate some ideas and things that you can actually do to get out of bed and try to take some action to feel better.
Excellent. And, you know, I absolutely agree. I had my, you know, how many people?
It's extremely common.
It is extremely common.
Yeah, at any time, about 15% of the population is diagnosed with depression. And I would say that probably 100% is affected either through personal experience or through dealing with somebody very close to them who's been going through it. So it's very common.
You know, I never thought that I'd be depressed. And then, you know, all of a sudden I get a brain tumor and boom, I'm depressed. And, you know, all the books that were thrown at me, it's like, yeah, okay, I can hardly get out of bed or brush my teeth.
Yes, so, yes. So when you're depressed, you have trouble remembering, focusing, concentrating. So to get a book with lots of writing, and I love to read, and I just couldn't focus long enough in order to access the information. So this book is written in short tips. It's written in a really loving language because you're so hard on yourself when you're depressed. And it's very practical. It gives you lots of good ideas.
It really is. You know, you gave me the book when we met in Victoria, and it's on the kitchen counter in my house, and I get up, and when I got the coffee brew in the morning, I get up and I just open it up and, you know, clear out some clutter.
Yeah, a simple thing. I mean, simple but not necessarily easy, depending on where you're at in your life. But, you know, just moving a few things out the door can make a big difference. And clutter can really contribute to depression because it's overwhelming. And again, if you don't have, you know, the energy to just take a shower, it's pretty tough to try to clear out your house. And especially if it's been a few years, it may have built up a bit.
Yeah, I can remember seeing my husband's car come down the driveway and run upstairs to jump in the shower.
Yes, I've been there, done that. Yeah, spent the whole day in my pajamas, just kind of zoned out. And went, oh no, it's 5 o'clock and I've done nothing.
Yeah, absolutely. So, oh, sorry, I'm seeing flying things over there, and I don't even have a brain tumor anymore, so it's all good. and it says, realize your memory is not going.
It's a symptom of depression. The chemistry in your brain has changed, and it doesn't work the same way. So it's not a personality fault. It's an illness.
Yeah, and knowing that you're not alone. This is a fabulous book. Thank you, Maria, for being on the show. Really appreciate it. And, you know, good luck with the sales of this book, because it's really great.
Thank you so much.
And from here, I am going to pass the set back over to Andrew, where he's going to interview our band.
Thanks so much, Lorraine. It's great to see Kait back in the studio. It's also great that, you know, whenever Matt Carter's not here, it seems that nobody loses an eye due to one of his flying pencils. So I think that's pretty cool. But anyway, I'm here with, we've got Joe. We had to keep the tradition going, I guess, so Kait took over for Matt. We're here with James. Jordan, Sam, Jordy, and Drew of local Nanaimo-based band Law & Social. Thanks for being here, guys.
No problem.
Excellent. So how did the five of you get together?
We actually all met in high school, so we're your typical kind of garage band, I guess you'd say. We got together for a talent show back in high school, and we've been together pretty much ever since. It's been about 5-6 years now, I think.
Perfect. You're playing live shows?
Yeah.
Do you have any CDs out?
Yeah, we do. We recorded about 2.5 years ago, I think, with Adam Sutherland from Infinity Studios in Victoria, and that was kind of our main EP, and we've kind of been slow since then, so we're slowly trying to work our way back in. We've kind of been in school and stuff like that, but we're all almost completed, so we're looking to make a bit of a comeback, get back in the scene. So
perfect. Well, it's hard to be, you know, the five guys who are having jobs and going to school. Mm-hmm. Hard to be, like, do the band thing too. So how do you guys delegate your responsibilities in the band?
Well, it depends. I think James typically has kind of been in charge of trying to get shows whenever shows pop up. And we've been around for a while, so sometimes, you know, guys will just come and ask us, you know, you want to play this show? And we're going to start looking to do a tour probably soon near the end of the summer here and get prepped as everyone's done school, and we're going to be good to go.
Perfect. Mm-hmm. So you're going to go into the studio, and what about your social media presence? How do you build that? Like Facebook, Twitter, what do you have?
Yeah, we've got Facebook and Twitter, so you can check us out at facebook.com/lawnsocial, and that's kind of our main form of communication with the outside world. So if you want to check that out and look us up, we got lots of fun stuff on there. We're going to be doing some videos, I think, coming up soon. So
how important is social media for you guys?
It's definitely important for getting yourself out there, for sure. Any shows, it's a good promotional tool. I'm still a big fan of, you know, the hard kind of promotion where you go out and you hand out posters and you go, you know, word of mouth is still huge, but social media is a way to do word of mouth. So it definitely helps.
Yeah, for sure.
It's huge.
Excellent. So now you guys, you're playing acoustic here tonight, but what is it like to see a full on rock show from Lawn Social?
It's great. But, you know, it's, yeah, progressive. It's a lot of different, you know, we've been playing around a lot with kind of different sounds and working just different types and styles of music. So it's kind of, you know, we'll have some low parts, some high parts. We'll get a lot more energy is kind of in our older stuff, and we're sort of starting to chill out, but still kind of keeping some of those same dynamics from when we were from our younger material. But it's, you know, it's interesting. It's a lot of different stuff, so it's great.
Perfect. You guys have a show coming up. Tell me
we
about
do.
That.
April 22nd, Monday, at the Dinghy Dock. It's an acoustic show. We typically don't play together acoustic. So it's been a lot of fun trying to...
First set acoustic.
Yeah.
Ever.
Basically, so...
Perfect. So it's a good chance for people to see you screw up.
Yeah, exactly. Well, yeah, we like to, you know, mix it up. So it's fun. It's fun to try and meld our songs into acoustic style. And so far, we felt it's worked out pretty well, but I'm sure you guys will be the judge of that.
Perfect. Well, thanks for being here, guys. Check them out on Facebook, facebook.com/lawnsocial. And take it away. You've got a song coming up. Wish you well.
Yep.
Thanks, guys.
Okay, yeah, no problem. Thank you.
Just wanna say I wish you well. As our hearts fall to fade away, you know it's never one kiss and tell. Cause that's what all the other girls say. The hardest part about it are the moments that make you fall back again. Dimpled away, I knew you couldn't stay, but I miss you. I miss you just like I always. And I kiss you, but the thought of it's hard not to make me sad. I know you're fine, these waves will break. Yeah, they're taking you back home, and this island man is giving chase. No, I'd rather just be.
I'm here today with Tony Bounsall, who is a professional photographer, graphic artist, visual artist, and we're going to talk about a process, and Kait mentioned it, photo encaustic collage. Tony, what's the whole process we're looking at
here? Well, we're using a mixture of beeswax, Damar resin crystals, and microcrystalline wax, and we're melting it down, and using it for a variety of purposes. One is to attach and collage different images together. Another is a vehicle that allows it to receive image transfers and build up. The whole process is building up layers and layers of transparent and translucent imagery. Okay. And I've just started started off with a transfer. A lot of the time what we're doing, we're working onto a surface that has to be receptive to the wax. So oftentimes we're working either with a birch plywood, or here this is a paper covered wooden panel. And so oftentimes I'll work with the paper because the wax actually sinks right into it. And I've just started this transfer. And this is a photocopy that's been transferred onto the surface. And from there, I'm probably will start using wax. And this is hot wax. You have to be kind of careful when you're working with this stuff.
And the wax is what builds up the layers?
It does. And it also adds a lovely kind of a kind of an optical veiling or softness to the look of things. In terms of the encaustic actually uses a process where you're heating the wax constantly. With a propane torch, you're moving, and it's almost like spray painting. You're kind of just keeping a flame over the wax, and the wax will eventually start kind of fusing into the paper. At that point, I'm ready to put, I can just put the torch down. I'm not going to turn it off. Okay. Put in my second layer. And I can see that, you know, the wax is still kind of warm. I'm putting down my second layer of wax over the top of that.
And this particular medium is just some tissue?
Yes, this is just tissue paper. And what's interesting is you notice, I mean, if you take a flame to a piece of tissue paper, it was starting to burn a bit there. But normally, what I would probably be doing is not using the flame so much as I might wind up using an iron to sort of soften and get in there and flatten this out. Another process is using the wax as a receiver for doing image transfers. And again, I put the wax down. Fuse it.
And people can use their own photographs in this kind of situation?
Yeah, oftentimes what we're doing is I recommend using photocopies, because a lot of the time people are tearing and you know, cutting up photographs and that type of thing. So if they've got some valued photographs, it's better to do a photocopy rather than use a photograph. And sometimes the photographic paper doesn't work. If it's old photographic paper, it will, but the newer resin-coated papers don't. So at this point, I just sort of check. That's still warm, and I can actually lay that onto. You can see I've just put the image down, face down, mm-hmm. And now I'm using, this is a bookbinding tool called a bone folder, and basically I'm transferring the imagery off the toner, off the photocopy, onto the hot wax, just by burnishing it. Mm-hmm. It takes a lot of elbow grease. I always tell students that when they think they've finished burnishing, the next thing they do is to keep burnishing. So it's a little bit laborious, but in the end, it works out well.
This process you were telling me is over 2,000 years old?
Yeah, the encaustic painting process is over 2,000 years old. And I'm using it less as a painting process and more as a sort of a mixed media hub. So you can work into the wax with oil colors. You can collage with it. You can do image transfers. We can draw into on the paper. You can draw into it with watercolors and all types of other stuff.
Well, we're going to continue with this and come back and show you some finished product. But right now, we're heading over to Bob, and he's going to talk about. I just got to check here. Literacy Nanaimo's tutoring program.
Brian? Yeah, okay. We're going to talk about Central Vancouver Island literacy. And today, please welcome to the show Jacqueline Webster, who is the literacy coordinator, tutor coordinator and Ron Bunham, who is a tutor with Central Vancouver Island Literacy. So welcome both of you to the show.
Thank you.
Well, we won't pay any attention to Brian. He doesn't know what he's doing anyway. So. Anyway, thanks for being here. Jacqueline, there's a partnership between Central VI Literacy, Central mm-hmm. VI, and VIU. Mm-hmm. Tell us
That's
about
right.
that.
So for the past 20 years, Literacy Central Vancouver Island and VIU have formed a partnership working to provide literacy tutoring for adults that need to upgrade their basic skills.
And 20 years, and so now how do people hear about the program and how do they come to you?
There's a wide range of ways that people come to us. Sometimes it's referral, it's word of mouth, just word on the street. Literacy Central Vancouver Island has been around for a long time, formerly was Literacy Nanaimo, and is very well known by various community organizations. Just even if you go into a bank, or sometimes I've had a referral from somebody who was involved in stroke rehabilitation. I mean, I think the word is out there, and so people just get referrals to us. There's lots of ways that people do come and see us.
Wonderful opportunities, yes. Ron, if I was looking for some assistance, I can speak, I can maybe read a little bit, but my writing skills are not that good. If I came to you, what am I going to do? How am I going to get involved with you?
Well, to begin with, Jacqueline would do an assessment of what the students, prospective students' needs were, and then also do the matching up of the student with the tutor, like trying to find a good match.
Well, so certain tutors, you're saying that one would be better with speech and one would be better with writing?
I think so, and also, based on past skills. And so what I bring is that I taught at VIU for about 30 years, and I worked in the writing center, and I ran the writing center there. So a lot of my skills transfer over to what happens at the Literacy Central. Some of the differences being that I'm dealing exclusively with adults now. And so I really need to do a lot of my own assessment at the beginning in terms of what their needs are. Some of the time there's learning deficits. Okay. Some of the time there's things that they've missed out on. And there's also bad habits that they picked up on. So a lot of what I have to do is to help people.
I have people. A lot of those, yeah. we all do.
Yeah, and people tend to cover up. And so a lot of what happens is the business of trying to undo bad habits getting
underway. How am I going to benefit now? When I sit down, we're involved in a program. What sort of time frame am I looking at?
It really depends on what the student is looking for. I've had people that want particular sort of results for a particular reason. They're wanting to head off to university. Others that are non-English Reader. Language speakers that are really trying to get more confidence in the language
ESL.
And develop ESL? Their ESL, develop their okay. vocabulary. Others who have had various sorts of medical issues in the past that have caused memory loss and so on. So there's a whole range of different kinds of things that people bring to Literacy Central. And what's really important for me is to develop a good relationship with them, really establish confidence in the process and in me, and have a lot of patience.
Jacqueline, now there's a number of different programs, and this particular one is about adult training, mm-hmm. Tutoring.
Right.
What are some of the other programs that you have available?
Well, there's actually a variety of adult tutor programs. So we have an Aboriginal program, we have an outreach program. The outreach program also involves working with with adults in corrections. We have an ESL program as well, and we also have Bears and Beams program. Literacy Central Vancouver Island runs the Bears and Beams program, and that helps children at risk or children that might need a little additional help in the school system itself.
So I was going to ask about, there's got to be some heartwarming stories, but unfortunately we're out of time. But you know, Jacqueline and Ron, thank you so much for coming and spending some time
thank
with
you.
Us today and telling us about the great work that Literacy Central VI is doing. And those other programs, I know I'm down the road, I want to have you back or whoever come back and we'll talk further about those other programs.
We'd love to talk about them. Yeah.
Thank you.
So thank you very much for coming today. And I think Brian has got something else up. Is it wax he's got up his sleeve? Well, I'm not sure where it is. Back to you, Brian.
Thanks, Bob. I have some wax in my hand, and it's actually wax on this photo encaustic collage. Mm-hmm. And this is one of the finished products that Tony has done previously. It shows you the graphics and the various layers, also various layers of wax and application.
Wax, and there's a number of different treatments going on there. You'll notice some lines in there that are incisions that have been put into the hot wax. There's graphite that's been rubbed into it, and oil color in some places.
So that's what the process looks like, and it's all cooled and finished. What we have here is the one you were working on.
That's right. I'm just sort of, you know, about three quarters of the way through. You'll remember I started off with a Xerox or a photocopy that I put face down, rubbed it into the hot wax, and then what I'm doing is I'm just taking either a spritzer or a damp paper towel and soaking the paper and then going in and actually removing the paper. And what's left is the toner that's been transferred into the hot wax.
Okay. Well, that's interesting in the process. And as we're talking here, I'm going to just find out, Tony, people who want to know about this process and get involved in it don't realize we're having a workshop. You're doing a workshop?
Yes, I'm doing a workshop up at the old schoolhouse in Qualicum Beach on the June 1st and 2nd weekend. And we'll be covering all of these techniques plus a lot more.
Okay, and you can contact the old schoolhouse, the Art Center, and register for this program. It's a workshop. Tony does a lot of things. We have his website, which is tonybounsall.com.
That's correct.
And you can find out, because you're in Victoria. You come all the way up to just show us this process, and actually we'll be teaching that workshop in Qualicum. They can also email you if you have any questions.
Absolutely.
We're posting that as well, tonybounsall@shaw.ca. So that's wonderful. This is a very interesting process. And, you know, as it looks like, you can sort of use variety of mediums. You don't have to be a great artist. You just apply different things here.
You're basically using a lot of either found photographs or their own, people's own photographs, or sometimes, for example, we've got in some of these, there's bits and pieces of napkins, there's found text, there's all kinds of stuff. So it's you're kind of bringing it all together and using the wax as a kind of a vehicle to hold it all.
Well, that's wonderful. Don't forget, contact Tony at his website or the old schoolhouse about the workshop coming up June 1st and 2nd.
Awesome. Thank you so much for coming in today. And Brian, thank you. That process looks really fascinating. And it's interesting that you say at the old schoolhouse, because I was thinking of mentioning that when you go and do the demos there, they have a like a little bar and a window that goes up
a
mirror so that you can see. So I'm throwing it out there wherever I'm supposed to be looking, which is right there, for Staz and Cam and everybody to okay that we make our own little mirror display so that the guys behind the camera don't have to climb up on those ladders anymore. And Todd's in the control and going, yes, yes. So that's 2 years in the coming, and maybe before another year we'll have that in place right here at the Shaw TV studio. That does bring us to the end of this edition, another edition, the 48th edition of the show. Thank you very much for watching. We always like your feedbacks, your comments, and your inputs. And there's some graphical information at the end where you can contact us. So thanks again for watching. Matt Carter will be back here for number 49. Have a good night.
The shot rings out. All I really want, your promise won't come true. And can you hear my voice through the crashing of the thunder as the rain pours down? I just stop to try and wonder why. Sorry, but I hope
Dodds Furniture's The Show is brought to you by Dodds Furniture and Mattress.